Hi everyone, I'm Jacob Lackner, and I'm bringing you a new history video for the first time in a while. I've been pretty busy, and I've been unable to keep up with the regular schedule here on Need to Hone History, but I still plan on putting out videos periodically, like the one we're doing today. So, everyone has heard of Marco Polo. He has one of the most recognizable names in history, so much so that children play a game in the swimming pool where they say his name. He was, of course, a 13th century merchant and explorer, best known for going on a long journey in the late 13th century from his native Venice along the Silk Road, and he spent significant time in Asia. He wrote down the details of his journey, and this is really the major reason why he's so well known today. There were other Italian adventurers and merchants who undertook similar journeys in the 13th century, but Marco Polo is the one who gets the most credit because he made sure to write down a record of his journey. Now, Marco Polo's journey was possible largely as a result of what is called the Pax Mongolica. You know, if you've heard of Pax Romana, meaning Roman peace, that was a period in the Mediterranean where the Romans ruled basically the entire thing, so travel was a lot safer and easier. Same thing happens with the Silk Road during the Mongol Empire because it's all under the control of one power. And so the Silk Road is easier to travel along starting in the 13th century, really. Now, the topic of this video obviously isn't Marco Polo, as you can tell from the title, but it's about another European traveler who went on his own long journey east and recorded lots of details, and he did it about 100 years before Marco Polo and before the Pax Mongolica was ever a thing. His name was Benjamin of Tudela. He didn't go as far east as Marco Polo, but his journey was still a notable one. He went from his hometown of Tudela in northern Spain, visited North and East Africa, the Arabian Peninsula, the Levant, Mesopotamia, Persia, and Europe. And like Marco Polo, he wrote it all down. In his case, in a Hebrew book called Sefer Ha-Massaot, or Book of Travels, and this book tells us about the various things he experienced and heard about on his journey. So, in this video, we're going to be doing two things. First, I'm going to talk about the context of Benjamin's journey and what might have motivated him to do what he did. To do this, we'll talk about what was going on in 12th century Spain. After that, we'll take a look at a few of the more notable passages of the Sefer Ha-Massaot. Benjamin was the first European to write about several things, including large-scale international trade, China, and more. Overall, Benjamin's writings will show us that the medieval world was incredibly vibrant, dynamic, and most importantly, interconnected. And none of those are words that people use to describe this time period. And you know me, I like to dispel misconceptions about the Middle Ages, and this time around we'll be doing it with this very specific document. And we're going to see that the world was already very interconnected 100 years before the Pax Mongolica, at least if you were a Jew. So, let's start by talking about Benjamin and the world in which he lived. Funnily enough, we don't know a ton about him, other than what we know from his book. We know that he was a Jew from Tudela, Spain, and we know that he undertook his journey from about 1157 to 1170. Based on his writing, he was probably both a religious scholar and a merchant. That might sound a bit odd to us today, but it really wasn't that unusual for Jewish men to have more than one profession. One of the most famous medieval Jewish scholars, who's from the same time period really as Benjamin, is Maimonides, who was famous as a religious scholar, but he was also a physician. But yeah, that's pretty much all we know about him for sure. He never outright tells us why he's on his trip or why he decided to record his experiences, but if we look at the context of his trip, along with the kinds of things he records, I think we uncover one clear possibility. And to discuss what those reasons and motivations were, we have to discuss Spain's history. And the biggest thing that probably motivated Benjamin to do what he did was that the Iberian Peninsula had very recently become far more unstable, especially for Jews. Up until about the year 1000, Spain had largely been under the control of the Umayyad Caliphate. These Muslim rulers tolerated Jews and Christians and integrated them into society. This period is characterized by the term convivencia, or living togetherness, a period where the three faiths had mostly peaceful relations with one another. In Jewish history, this time period is often called the Golden Age of Spanish Jewry. During the period of the Umayyad Caliphate, a lot of rules were broken that had been established, namely the idea that Jews weren't supposed to serve in positions of power over Muslims. That was largely ignored, and Jews during this era served in important positions in the government and were an important part of medieval society in the Iberian Peninsula. But that golden age eventually came to an end, as new pressures, both from the north and the south, would transform the Iberian Peninsula. Around the year 1000, the Umayyad Caliphate of Cordoba collapses, and this leads to a less unified state, a less unified Muslim state in the Iberian Peninsula. And this enables Christians, who have sort of been kept only to the extreme northern part of the Iberian Peninsula for several hundred years, this allows them to start to find a lot more success in battle against the Muslim powers in the south that are now far less unified. And these conquests would ultimately result in Christians controlling about half of the Iberian Peninsula by about 1120. And this included Benjamin's hometown of Tudela, which was captured in 1119 by the Kingdom of Navarre. Now, Benjamin probably wasn't alive yet, and if he was very young, but it was still something that had happened in the relatively recent past, and he would have known people who lived in Tudela when it was under Muslim control, and then also lived in it when it was under Christian control. These new Christian conquerors from the north were significantly less tolerant of Jews, and especially less tolerant of Muslims. While Jews in Tudela and elsewhere were still tolerated, they weren't as integrated into society, and they were no longer able to hold important posts within the government, and they lost a lot of their power that they possessed, and a lot of their autonomy that they possessed under Muslim rulers. And this likely caused some to think about the future of the Jewish community within Christian Spain. So that sort of covers the pressure coming from the north that is starting to change the Iberian Peninsula. Let's talk about the south now. So after decades and decades of losing battles to the Christian powers in the north, the Muslim states in the Iberian Peninsula ask for help from an outside force. And they ask for one of their neighbors, really, the Almoravids, who rule in northwestern Africa. They ask them to come into the Iberian Peninsula and help them defeat the Christians so they can at least hold on to the territory they still have. And the arrival of the Almoravids in 1094 is usually the date historians use to mark the end of the golden age of the Spanish Jewry, and that should tell you that things aren't going to go nearly as well for Jews, even in Muslim-controlled territory, from this point on. Ultimately, the Almoravids would unite most of the Spanish states in Spain, and they would find some success in battle against the Christians, halting their advances. But these Muslim rulers were not like the Umayyads or others who came before them. They were far less tolerant towards Jews and Christians, and they claimed that the whole reason that Muslim rulers had failed against Christians was because they were far too tolerant. This led to large-scale persecution of both religious groups. But believe it or not, things would get even worse, and this would be during the lifetime of Benjamin of Tudela. In 1147, another group of Muslim invaders arrive. These were called the Almohads. This group had its origins around Morocco, and by 1147, they had toppled the Almoravids, taking their territory in North Africa and in Spain. And they were Muslim extremists. They didn't just persecute religious minorities with official policies. They believed that Jews and Christians needed to be converted, killed, or expelled. This goes against what is traditional policy of Muslims towards Jews and Christians, which is a policy of tolerance, where they're allowed to continue to practice their religion. They just can't be in positions of power over Muslims, and there are various other restrictions. But what the Almohads want to do is far more intense and violent than anything that has happened to any Jews or Christians in the Iberian Peninsula, pretty much in their history. So during the lifetime of Benjamin of Tudela in the north, Christians were persecuting Jews and limiting their rights in a way that earlier Muslim rulers never had, and in the south, the Almohads were outright massacring Jews. In other words, no matter who ultimately won the ongoing conflict between Muslims and Christians, Jews would not be in a great position. They would never go back to the Golden Age. So with all of that context in mind, it's very likely that Benjamin undertook his journey as a research trip, one where he could visit various Jewish communities and examine what their lives were like. One of the things that he focuses the most on throughout his itinerary is what the population of Jews is in every place he visits. He offers a round figure for each of these places, lists the name of prominent Jews in the community, and discusses the kind of work that Jews in a given area were doing. In a lot of ways, it's almost like he's reviewing the various Jewish populations and Jewish communities throughout the world as he's going on his trip, letting people know, hey, this place has a lot of Jews and they work in the profession of dyeing, which is really lucrative. Or, hey, the Jews who live in this city are persecuted by the people who rule it, so not such a great place to go. So the fact that he takes the time to do this, coupled with the reality of what was happening in the Iberian Peninsula, really seems to indicate that his book is supposed to be educational for the Jewish community back home in the Iberian Peninsula, so they could come to understand how Jews were faring elsewhere in the world. It is worth noting, though, that Benjamin doesn't just comment about these very Jewish things. He's also quite fascinated by the various peoples he meets and provides an ethnography of sorts for many different groups of people, whether Muslim, Christian, Jewish, or none of the above. However, his second most prominent area of interest seems to be in trade routes, especially those around the Arabian Peninsula and into the Indian Ocean. This second interest may be connected to his first. He's interested in what kind of trade Jews do in the various parts of the world. So that's enough about Benjamin, the context of his journey, and why he went on his journey in the first place. Let's take a look now at some important passages from the text, and we'll discuss each of them individually. First, let's take a look at a couple of documents where Benjamin goes pretty deep on discussing international trade, showing us his interest in the topic. Let's begin with Benjamin's description of Alexandria. At the time, Alexandria, Egypt, was one of the most important trading posts in the world as it was positioned on the Mediterranean Ocean and was also accessible via the Nile River. Here's what Benjamin had to say about Alexandria. He writes, "It's a commercial market for all the nations. Merchants are there from all Christian kingdoms. On the one side, from the lands of Venice and Lombardy, Tuscany, Apulia, Amalfi, Sicily, Calabria, Rome, Khazaria, Patiznakia, Hungary, Bulgaria, Ragusa, Croatia, Slavonia, Russia, Germany, Saxony, Denmark, Courland, Ireland, Norway, Frisia, Scotland, England, Wales, Flanders, Hainault, Normandy, France, Poitiers, Anjou, Burgundy, Maurienne, Provence, Genoa, Pisa, Gascony, Aragon, and Navarre, and towards the west under the sway of the Muslims, Andalusia, that means Muslim Spain, Algarve, Africa, and Arabia. On the other side, India, Zuila, Abyssinia, Libya, Yemen, Babylon, Syria, Greece, and the Turks. And merchants of India bring all kinds of spices, and the Christian merchants buy them. The city is always full of traffic, and each nation has an inn of its own." So one really gets an image of a very busy and diverse marketplace from his description. He names pretty much everywhere he possibly can think of when talking about who's there from Europe, and he does the same for most of the Islamic world. So Christians and Muslims are meeting there to trade, but that's not all. There's also merchants from India who are there who are bringing spices. So you have people from all over the world all meeting in Alexandria for trade, and this isn't really the kind of trading market that people think of when they think of 12th century Europe, but this is what was going on. Alexandria is a major hub of economic activity and one that attracted people from all over the world. The idea that each nation has an inn of its own is pretty notable too, as it implies that each of these groups has their own place set up where merchants and other travelers from those specific places can rest there. This is something that we hear a lot about at pilgrimage sites like in Jerusalem, but there appears to have been a similar practice when it came to merchants too. These places would have allowed them to speak their native languages and feel a little more at home than they might have otherwise felt in such a chaotic and diverse environment. Now that we've discussed Alexandria, let's take a look at Benjamin's description of another trading post. This is one that is significantly less well known, the island of Kish. This island is located in the Persian Gulf about 30 miles off of the coast of what is today Iran. The island was easily accessible via the Indian Ocean and the Tigris River, making it an important point of contact for those living in Mesopotamia and those further east into Asia. While Kish Island isn't quite as busy as Alexandria, Benjamin does describe it as an important place when it comes to international commerce. Here he writes, "Then one returns to the land of Khuzestan, which is by the river Tigris, and one goes down the river which falls into the Indian Ocean unto an island called Kish. It is a 6 days' journey to reach the island. The merchants who come from India encamp there with their wares. Moreover, men from Babylon, El Yemen, and Persia bring all sorts of silk, purples and flax, cotton, hemp, worked wool, wheat, barley, millet, rye, and all sorts of foods and lentils of every description, and they trade with one another, while the men from India bring great quantities of spices. The islanders are middlemen and earn their livelihood that way. There are about 500 Jews there." So, Kish Island is mostly a major trading post for Indian merchants, it would seem, who have permanent shops there and sell their goods to people who are from further west. It's also interesting that Benjamin calls these islanders middlemen, who sell the goods they get from Indian merchants to other people. And many of these middlemen are apparently Jewish, which isn't too surprising. By this point, Jews have a long-standing position as merchants, both in Europe and the Islamic world. So, like Alexandria, this is an important trading post. And it's also pretty important in the context of Benjamin's work. He only went as far east as Persia, but Sefer Ha-Massaot also contains a lot of information about places that are much further east, including India, Mongolia, China, and Tibet. These aren't places that he visited personally, but he writes what he heard about them, and while he doesn't tell us this directly, it seems likely that he learned about these places on Kish Island. In general, these two passages about trade show us that the medieval world was quite vibrant and interconnected, with trade really bringing diverse groups of people together. Now that we've covered international trade, let's take a look at a few more passages from Sefer Ha-Massaot. These two passages deal with India and China, and largely contain that information that Benjamin got probably during his time on Kish Island. First, let's see what he has to say about India. He writes, from Zabid, it is an 8-day journey to India, which is on the mainland. The country is mountainous, there are many Israelites there, and they are not under the yoke of the Gentiles. They possess cities and castles on the summits of the mountains, from which they take descents into the plain country, where they take spoils and booty and return to the mountains. No one can defeat them. The most fascinating thing about this passage is that Benjamin claims there are many Jews there, so many in fact that they are independent and have their own cities and castles in the mountains. There isn't any other historical document that supports the idea of these autonomous Jews, and one wonders who told Benjamin about this. However, he may be describing the group of Jews who settled on the Malabar coast. These Jews are called Cochin Jews or Malabar Jews. And if that is what Benjamin is writing about here, his itinerary is the first time they're mentioned in a historical document, as they only start showing up more regularly about 100 years later. But they were never an autonomous group who were a group of warriors that nobody could defeat. So this is a pretty important historical reference that somebody may have been telling him about Jews who actually settled on the Malabar coast, but it seems like whoever told him this story may have also exaggerated, you know, just how autonomous and powerful these Jews were. Next, let's take a look at the passage that discusses China. Notably, Benjamin was the first European to ever refer to China by that name, and he wrote the following. Then, to cross over to the land of China is a voyage of 40 days. China is the easternmost place, and some say that there is the Sea of Nikpa, where the Orion star predominates and stormy winds prevail. At times, the helmsman cannot govern his ship as a fierce wind drives her into the sea, where she cannot move from her place. And the crew have to remain where they are until the stores of food are exhausted and they die. In this way, many a ship has been lost, but men eventually discovered a means by which to escape from this evil place. The crew provides themselves with hides of oxen, and when this evil wind blows them into the sea, they wrap themselves up in them, and armed with knives, plunge into the sea. A great bird called the griffin spies them out, and in the belief that the sailor is an animal, the griffin seizes hold of him, brings him to dry land, and puts him down on a mountain in a hollow in order to devour him. The man then kills the bird and escapes. This passage is really interesting in the context of the rest of Benjamin's itinerary, which is for the most part very grounded. I mean, yes, we just talked about him describing a group of autonomous Jews in India, but it isn't that much of a stretch to say that maybe they exist. This is really the only passage within this text that I think we can call fantastical. And for that reason, I think we can say that he certainly believed this to be the case. Clearly, someone told him the story of this griffin that saves men from the dangers of the ocean in China, and he thought it was worth including in his book. It's notable, too, that Marco Polo would make reference to a similar bird around 100 years later, indicating that the story of this griffin was still around by the time he went on his journey. Another interesting thing about this passage is that Benjamin and his discussion of the weather and the dangerous winds and the seas and everything might actually be based on some reality. So whoever told him this story may have included, you know, that information, which might have been true. There's not a sea called the Sea of Nikpa, but he may be referring to a place called Ningbo, which is on the East China Sea, and it's a place with really rough seas during storm season where people do often end up trapped or die, especially during this time when ships were less advanced. So he may have actually heard those real details intermixed with this story of the griffin. And in general, it's really interesting to think about the parts of his itinerary where he didn't actually visit places, but he wanted to tell people about them. The question is whether these people he was talking to who relayed this information to him, did they really believe what they were saying to him about a group of autonomous Jews or about a griffin grabbing people, or are they just really pulling his leg because they're like, this poor guy doesn't know anything about the East, so let's just have some fun with him. In the end, Benjamin's book is an important source for us. It informs us about trade routes and international trade during his time, the populations of Jews in various cities, the first medieval European perspectives on the Far East, and he also offers us a glimpse into the culture and daily lives of people in many of the cities he visits. After reading this book, or at least these passages, one comes away with the idea that the medieval world was very much interconnected. As we saw, exchanges of goods and culture were quite commonplace. If you're interested in reading Benjamin's itinerary, you're in luck, as it's available in an English translation. If you thought these selections were interesting, I think you'll enjoy the book on the whole, and I'll put the link in the description. Well, that does it for this video. Hopefully I'll post another one before too long. I'm hoping to do at least one a month going forward. Thanks.